So hi everyone, my name is J.F. Garrard and I'm the deputy editor of Ricepaper magazine. So today we have a special guest from south of our border, Mr. Simon Tam. Simon was born and raised in San Diego, California. He is the founder and bassist of the Slants, one of the first all-American dance rock bands in the world. And he also leads the Slants Foundation, a nonprofit organization that provides resources and mentorship for artists that incorporate activism into their work. He has earned many awards for his work as an author, musician, activist, and entrepreneur, including the Mark T. Banner Award from the American Bar Association, the Hugh M. Hefner First Amendment Award, and the Ovation Lifetime Achievement Award. In 2019, he published his memoir, Slanted, How an Asian American Troublemaker Took on the Supreme Court. It was named one of the best books on the Constitution of all time by Book Authority and won an award for best memoir from the independent publisher Book Awards. Simon continues to fight for justice by serving on multiple nonprofit boards, developing innovative solutions to social problems and sharing a message of radical optimism. And he's done so much, I can't list everything in a minute. So please visit his website, simontam.org or theslants.com to learn more about all the wonderful work that he does. So I'd like to thank Simon for taking the time to talk to Ricepaper Magazine virtually during this COVID pandemic. Now, Ricepaper Magazine is Canadian, so I'm not sure how familiar our readers are with your work and your vision. So can we start off with you telling us a little bit about yourself, who you are, what you do, why you do things?
Sure. Well, I oftentimes like to say that I'm a troublemaker. I like to disrupt systems and conventions and try and provide a different perspective to things, or a different slant, if you will. And so I used to think that my work was music, that, you know, growing up, all I wanted to do was play music. But I realized that there was a larger vision behind that. And that vision was to see change in the world, to see something that, to bring it to life that didn't exist before, and to find an avenue for expression. And so then I realized, hey, that's not just music, it's also storytelling, it's writing, it's all the different things that I do in the nonprofit world, is saying, like, this doesn't exist, but I really think it ought to, and seeing what steps I need to do in order to make it happen. And so my work has kind of appeared in a lot of different forms, though I still kind of first and foremost identify as a musician.
Yeah, so you have music, I know you have a few books, you do talks all around the world, and has your not-for-profit, so I see the word not-profit, I was like, okay. Is that growing more, like, because it's the Science Foundation, like,
yeah,
how do you divide up your time now?
In 2019, our band actually retired from live touring. You know, I still do appearances on my own, and I sometimes will do events with my guitarist, although, you know, the past year or so, that really hasn't happened all that much. And so we've been able to kind of focus our time, our resources, and our energy on the foundation side of things, which, you know, is something I've been wanting to do for a long time, which is to start my own nonprofit to help benefit those other artists of Asian descent, kind of help develop more sustainable and scalable arts careers, whether it's music, writing, dance, theater, or whatever form of expression that they might have. We just try and help step in by providing mentorship and resources to help make that happen.
Is it mainly for musicians, or is it other types of arts as well?
No, it's all forms of art. So last year, for example, we helped fund a photography project, a film, a dance, theater project, in addition to a couple of albums. And it just kind of depends. We're mostly looking for artists who are working with communities in terms of, like, bringing advocacy to their work. So incorporating that message of activism, but in a way that's not just like talking or singing about a problem. We really want to encourage folks to do it in a way that actually can advocate for systems transformation or policy change. And that oftentimes means working with a local organization or charity to make that happen.
Oh, that's so cool. Now, when I first got in touch with you, it was because through your PR people, they were talking about the Asian American Music Video Festival and AsianAmericanMovies.com. So I believe the Slants are releasing a bunch of videos on this and your documentary. So how did this collaboration come about? Like, did you contact them?
I think I was, so Quentin Lee is a filmmaker and director and writer. He started AsianAmericanMovies.com, and I think we've just kind of been on each other's radar for quite a number of years. We first kind of started working together in a more official capacity when he launched a web series during the pandemic called Co-Misery, and he asked to use some of our songs, which, you know, we gladly provided to him. And then when he was talking about the launch of AsianAmericanMovies.com, he said, hey, would you be interested in having a whole channel just dedicated to all the music videos and content that we had, you know, developed over the years with the Slants? So I said, sure. I was like, we actually filmed a whole documentary about us traveling and touring in Taiwan, so let's include that as well. And then he was also pretty aware of the Slants Foundation work, and I thought, why don't we just, like, instead of making it exclusive to our band, what if we developed a platform to help other up-and-coming artists to highlight their work, and we can help curate maybe a bunch of music videos or something like that. So that's when the idea for the AAMV festival was kind of born. We thought, this is cool. Like, throughout the year, let's choose groups of eight music videos produced by various folks from Asian Pacific Islander descent. We could kind of talk about their work. We can help highlight it and let other people know about the amazing talent that's within the community.
Well, that's pretty cool. Now, referencing the documentary, when did you guys go to Taiwan?
That was 2016, I believe. Yeah.
Okay. So how did it feel to go back as an Asian American? Like, are you very fluent in Chinese? I remember going to Taiwan and someone was like, just slur your Cantonese a bit, and that did not work. And so, you know, it was like a culture shock, like, for me to go back to Asia.
I loved it. I mean, so, you know, our band was based in Portland, Oregon, and a lot of times people talk about Portland as a foodie city. Well, Taiwan is like a foodie country. Like, I mean, it is unparalleled in terms of just the quality of food that you can have all over the place. And I've been all over the world, and it's probably my favorite place to eat my way through.
Yeah.
We, going there as an Asian American band is interesting, though, because, like, all of a sudden, nobody called us the Asian American band. Yes. Whereas in the US, that's how we're referred to all the time. And when we went to Asia, we were the American band. So, like, already we were kind of being distinguished as that. Now, a couple of us do speak Mandarin. I speak Mandarin rather poorly, but my guitarist was born and raised in China. And then we have a friend of ours who also is on the Slants Foundation board right now. He was kind of acting as our tour guide. He was actually lived in Taiwan for many years. So it was great to have somebody who just kind of knew the cities quite well, knew the systems to help guide us through. And it ended up being great. And in fact, I oftentimes say, like, one of the best ways to learn a language or to re-pick up a language is just to simply be in this space where you're just immersed in it. And over the week and a half or 2 weeks that we were there, it was amazing to see how, like, my own Mandarin kind of just changed from the beginning of the trip to the end of the trip. And it was a lot of fun. I mean, we loved it. There were a lot of expatriates, and there's a lot of, you know, local Taiwanese folks who spoke English as well. So getting around was actually pretty easy. And yeah, it was just a lot of fun. And it was also probably the first time that we had built a tour that wasn't just structured on us playing every single night. Like, I was like, you know, I want time off in between so we can just explore and have a great time. And so the film that we created as a result was really kind of a reflection of that. Like, there are moments where there's, like, concert clips, but it really feels more like an episode of No Reservations, just, you know, both a much better soundtrack. It was just like us going to places and eating and checking out really amazing historical sites. It's just a lot of fun.
So did you guys visit any of your ancestral homes at all? My sister did one similarly when she went back to China, and she found, you know, the village where my grandma grew up and stuff like that.
Well, so I'm the only person in the band of Taiwanese descent. Oh. And but I didn't grow up in Taiwan. Like, I was born and raised in San Diego. That being said, I did end up meeting up with a family that was there. So one of my aunts, we met up, and it was really nice to see her. I met my second cousin for the first time. Like, we've been friends on Facebook for many years, but like, we never actually interacted. So that was really great to kind of be able to see family while there. I did visit Taiwan as a kid, but I was maybe 3 or 4 years old. It looked a lot different. And, you know, like, we saw family photos and video footage of the experience from when I was a kid, but it was like, went from this tiny little island that resembled kind of like a fishing town to like a huge, major, super modern metropolis with some of the most like cutting edge technology that's out there. So it was just radically different just from my expectations.
Yeah, I remember going to Hong Kong, I think when I was 4. I was born and raised in Toronto in Canada. And I remember my mom taking me back, and I was asking her, how come Chinatown doesn't end? Why does it keep on going?
Yeah.
Just on and on. Now, I read in an interview that in 2012, your band was offered $4 million by a record label with a condition that the lead singer be replaced with a Caucasian one. And I'm sad to say that I'm not surprised. But I mean, with all the wokeness that's happening today, do you think things have improved for Asian Americans in the music industry? Because at the same time, I see people like superstars from China, like the Chris Wu's and the Lay Zhang with their rap albums, and they come and they make, you know, multi-million dollar music videos and stuff. Like, it's like a different animal, but, you know, then they're a different genre because they do mostly rap and hip hop. But like, have things improved since you've started to now, do you think?
I'd like to say that, yeah, it's improved in kind of marginal degrees. Like, you still don't see any kind of mainstream Asian American acts that are doing rock and roll. Like, you know, like, yes, K-pop's getting popular and that kind of thing, but it's really seen as like an import culture. Like, oh, that's from Korea, that's, you know, Japanese, it's et cetera. Like, we're bringing it in, and oftentimes it's still treated as like those people are Asians. They're like other people, not necessarily like homegrown acts. And I think that there's a lot of that kind of still doubt over the kind of marketability of Asian American acts to be accepted. You know, we do see a number of people that have been like wildly successful. They just don't have the kind of the Asian part of their Asian American identity out front. So like Bruno Mars or Darren Criss, like, they're obviously doing very, very well for themselves. So most people don't even think of them as Asian. They're, you know, they're biracial, and they kind of emphasize the other parts of their identity.
Yeah, I mean, I can sort of see, in a way, like, when you're trying to succeed, it's sort of like, what's the most advantageous card you can play, right? So, and then if they're by, they don't necessarily have to play the Asian card, they can play something else.
And then, yeah, and I don't blame them. I mean, they're just, they're trying to make a living, they're trying to create art, and I get it. And to a certain extent, they have, you know, PR folks, they have a label that's helping shape their careers. But I will say that because the traditional gatekeepers for the entertainment industry have kind of slowly been losing their power over the last few years, especially with social media and the rise of independent platforms, it's really provided a way for other folks to kind of take their own power and create their own systems. And so we see a lot of Asian American artists who are doing quite well for themselves in the independent circuit. They're making a sustainable living, and you know, they might not be topping the Billboard charts necessarily, but they're slowly demonstrating that, hey, we can do this and we can make money and we can make a viable income from this. And I think as a result, many labels are starting to take that second look. It was the same thing like when Fresh Off the Boat was killing it, when Crazy Rich Asians was dominating the charts. Like, all of a sudden, all these studios are like, oh, maybe we should have some Asian people in our TV shows and movies now.
Yeah, you know, I'm still like, waiting for the Marvel movie to come out.
it's coming soon. Hey, you got a Canadian Asian in there.
Yes, our own.
So
hopefully that'll do well and it'll open the door. And I know there was a Hallmark movie with a Asian Canadian like lead, like in a romantic, whatever, Christmas comedy.
That's right. And more being filmed too. So like, I do acting on the side and I see like way more casting calls and roles than ever before. I mean, sometimes it's still very generic. Like, you know, we need someone of Asian descent, or they could also be Hispanic or Black, but like that's their Asian character. And they're like, yeah, someone, you know, who's age 15 to 50. Like, so you know that role is not like a very well-developed character, but they're trying to add some more color, I guess, to whatever productions they're making. And, you know, I think the more it happens, the more it's normalized, and the more that we see mm-hmm. roles that are not like stereotypical roles, the more that we'll see it just kind of edge out and make it slightly easier for the next person. And I'd like to think that the same thing is happening in the music world as well. Like, the more that we start seeing that kind of diverse set of acts across multiple genres, the more it'll be easier for the next person who's coming through, because they won't necessarily face some of the same obstacles, or at least if they do, you know, hopefully the road would be slightly smoother for them.
Okay, so you had written a memoir, right? The Slanted, How an Asian American Troublemaker Took on the Supreme Court. Can you talk a little bit about your advocacy work and that battle that you had with the Supreme Court, and why was it such an important fight for you?
Sure. So a lot of that kind of struggle originated just from the most casual of conversations. Like, I met an attorney and he was just like, hey, do you have a registered trademark for the band name? Mm-hmm. And I, at the time, was like, this sounds like a very expensive thing. But he says, no, it's just a few hundred dollars. It'll take 6 months. The whole thing will be over, but you really need it, you know, mm-hmm. to be able to have a viable music career. It's important to protect your rights. So I said, all right, let's go for it. That process ended up costing a whole lot more and taking up almost 10 years of my life, because the US government said, hey, the name of your band, the Slants, it's actually offensive to Asian people. And we were like, but we are Asian people. We work in the Asian American community. We do anti-racism work. What are you talking about? And it became this really long, you know, back and forth legal battle for years and years. And through that process, I learned that the law that they were using against me had been around about 70 years. And it turns out that it was primarily only used against communities of color and members of the LGBTQ community, because, you know, we tend to be the kinds of people that reappropriate language, saying like, this formerly offensive term or this stinging imagery, we're going to co-opt it and then turn it upside down. But it turns out it made us like prime targets under this law that was supposedly trying to like make the marketplace less offensive for people. And so we decided to challenge this. And year after year, we continue to appeal until we got to a federal court where we finally won. And then the government turned it around and it sued me and took me to the Supreme Court. But we won there unanimously. And we were able to overturn this law and finally open things up so that, you know, folks from marginalized communities could finally get the same level, the same equal playing field as other folks, other corporations, to kind of choose what's appropriate for themselves.
Well, it sounds like it was a very challenging endeavor. I mean,
I wouldn't suggest it. I would not wish it upon anybody. It is.
Yeah.
It's tough. Like, you hear about cases that go to the Supreme Court or these major law cases. Yeah. And all we hear about is like kind of like the arguments for or against at the yeah. end. But we rarely understand what it's like for the person actually going through it. And so I, you know, over the last few years, I ended up speaking at a ton of lawyer events, law conventions, law schools, and that sort of thing. And they're always asking, like, what's it like? What's it like being in the room? Or, you know, what's it like from the client side? And I thought, even these lawyers and these so-called experts in law, they don't even understand it. So I wanted to make sure that story was captured so that we try and hopefully provide a little bit more empathy for folks who are going through this kind of process, and also to kind of expose, like, this is how the law works. We have laws that on paper, they sound really good, but in practice, how they're enforced can actually be extremely problematic. And so, you know, I wanted to showcase that through my memoir. And also, you know, you don't hear a lot about what it's like to be an independent musician, especially a musician of color. So I wanted to kind of contrast that. I go back and forth between like talking about touring, playing shows, the weird things we encountered, like having to reject a record label offer on the premise of like, you know, replacing my Asian singer or someone who's white, all that stuff. And then, in my, you know, after the shows and on the tour bus, I'm like reading legal documents and trying to fight this other thing and just trying to balance that while still having like a regular human life, like just trying to be a person, you know? So, yeah, it was a really fun project to work on. I'm really proud of it. And I'm glad that the stories are kind of now being shared and hopefully providing a glimpse to other people, like what it was actually like.
Okay, so why don't we have a little bit of a break now? Well, break for me, but I'm gonna ask you to do a short reading from your book, Slanted, How an Asian American Troublemaker Took on the Supreme Court. So Simon's just gonna read a few minutes and then we'll ask him a little bit about publishing it afterwards.
Sure. So I got a passage here from when I was in Washington, D.C. the first time going to court, like the federal court. And when I was kind of like we were making our rounds, we would get contacted by tons of journalists. Like sometimes I'd be on calls for 13 to 16 hours a day and, you know, from folks all around the world and all the different time zones. And this was just a really kind of quirky story about names, the importance of names and identity, and also like demonstrates how poor my Mandarin was at the time. So, as I started making plans for Washington, D.C., our guitarist Joe asked if he could join so that he could film a documentary about my journey through the courts. I set up a number of interviews for him with scholars in the area. A few Asian American organizations and teachers also asked me to speak at their schools. We ended up with a packed schedule that would keep us busy from morning to night. It felt like we were going on tour since I was trying to fill every minute of the day with something productive. Joe would pepper me with questions for his documentary while I drove the rental car. It was like I was constantly on. It felt a bit uncomfortable, even though it was a friend behind the lens. And sometimes a television crew or journalist would meet us on location for one of my appearances and ask even more questions. It was mentally and emotionally draining. And I'm fairly certain that I just stopped answering questions at one point because I wanted some kind of reprieve. In the middle of our trip, Joe's cousin, Yin, drove up from North Carolina to hang out with us. When he mentioned how hungry he was, even after we had already eaten two back-to-back meals, I knew we'd get along. At one point, I was doing an interview with a newspaper in China and was asked for my written Chinese name. I didn't know how to type Chinese characters, so I wrote out my name on a piece of paper and I asked for Joe's help. Joe was born and raised in China for most of his childhood, where I was being denied from being able to learn the language while I was in school. "What's that?" He stared, he rotated the paper, and he laughed. Yin looked over, but he couldn't make sense of what I had written either. "I only know how to write a few things in Chinese. My own name, the numbers 1 through 4, mom, and food. That's it. Or at least I thought that was it." "Well, some of these aren't even real characters," he said. "Say your name." "Tom Shuwen? Tam Shuwen? I know, my pronunciation sucks." We then called up my dad to try and make sense of it. He tried explaining it over as well, but the intonation wasn't very clear over the phone. "Shu as in number, or are you saying shu as in book? Or is it like shu as in like unique?" With so many variations and possible combinations of characters in Chinese, it seemed impossible to decipher what was happening. It was ironic that while I was fighting so hard to fight for my identity, I couldn't even figure out how to write out my own name, even with the help of 3 other men who were born in China. Finally, after 30 minutes, we figured out my name, Tang Shuwen. I think we often forget the importance of names. I was actually born Simon Xiao Tam on March 31st, 1981, at least according to my parents. Growing up, I had a couple different middle names. My paper trail through the public school system will sometimes list my middle name as Hong, like my father's, and sometimes Xiao, from my mother's side of the family. I didn't really know which one to choose. I just knew that no matter what, the word began with an H, so that my initials of SHT would either be a badass proclamation or a target for ridicule. But this wasn't exactly the whole story. My birth certificate revealed that both my birthday and my name were wrong, at least according to the state. I was born Simon Shao Tam, but they spelled it S-H-I-A-O instead of H-S-A-I-O, and the date was March 30th, 1981. I was no longer S-H-T, but S-S-T, something that sounded like a large antiquated cargo barge. And there was a lot going on at the time. I could see how mistakes could be made. On the day I was really born, President Ronald Reagan was, and several of his staff members were shot in broad daylight. But the reality is that this isn't the first time the government screwed up names in my family. As different relatives entered the US and dealt with different officials, our family name was interpreted and recorded differently. That's why my father, his parents, his grandparents, and his siblings all have different last names: Tam, Tom, Tong, and Tan. Identity matters. When simple mistakes are made due to ignorance or poor translation, these can create difficulties later on for families trying to communicate, share resources, or navigate government systems that often require accuracy. Identity is inherently tied with dignity. We should be able to define ourselves based on our own terms and to identify ourselves as part of a community. Yet, what we find is that people from marginalized groups often have others defining their identities for them. The status of their citizenship, the categories for racial and ethnic groups as defined by the dominant population, or, as in my family's case, how names are spelled and pronounced. The simple, lighthearted misunderstanding with the Chinese journalist reminded me of the importance of names. Some names are sacred, passed through generations for thousands of years. Through laziness and misinterpretation, our family name was butchered at the hands of immigration officials and getting further lost with each passing generation that was forced to assimilate. I vowed never to forget my name again. Some names are worth fighting for.
Very nice. That was really eye-opening, and I really liked the writing. It was very clear.
Oh, thank you.
Got your message across. It's such a tragedy that they did all that stuff to your name. Did you get it corrected before you went to the Supreme Court? Like, was it
No. Well, the Supreme Court is interesting in that they're still using the spelling from my birth certificate. Yeah. So I kind of had to keep that misspelling in order to for taxes and other important government documents. But it also, the Supreme Court brief also shed some light on the carelessness and how they treat identity. So the official opinion from the Supreme Court actually lists me as the lead singer of the band, even though I've never been the lead singer of the band. And I'm like, is it because you can't tell us apart? Or is it because you couldn't even trouble yourself to do a quick search on Google, you know? Yeah. And they actually got that piece of data because the trademark office, the entity that we're fighting against, also wrongly listed me as the lead singer. And it just shows like they didn't really actually care that much about the person. You know, they're thinking about these larger legal issues. But when you don't care about people who are at the heart of laws, you end up perpetuating these kind of inequities that will affect people in many different profound ways that they don't have to think about what it means for them. But like, you know, for me, it's a different lived reality. For example, like they're like, well, hey, if we get it wrong, you can always come and correct us, which sounds good in theory, but it took me over a decade to correct the government who assumed that the name of my band was racist. So for 10 years of me trying to pursue a music career, I had an actual government department calling me racist. And that affects me in all kinds of profound ways, including my own anti-racism work. They don't have to think about what that means, even though they were the ones that incorrectly identified me as such. But it just shows that like the importance of trying to change these systems to actually reflect the identities of the people who are affected by them so that we don't have these kinds of mistakes continue to hurt people and harm them in all these other unexpected ways, in ways that, you know, are oftentimes not reported on because it's so complex. Like, how do you write a news story around it? How do you do a quick soundbite around it?
Now, your book was independently published, right? Like, you published it yourself, or did you go to a publisher?
Well, we shopped it around for a while. I had two different book agents, and what was interesting is that, unfortunately, the publishing industry is very much like the entertainment industry. there's still a lot of gatekeepers. I was told on a couple of occasions, like, we already have an Asian writer. Like, from, I'll say that came from one of the biggest, four biggest publishers in the world. They said that to me. And I was like, yeah, but they write fiction. It's a completely different genre. And it's also a different human being. Like, I was like, I don't know how many male writers do you have? You got problems with signing up more? Like, it was just mind boggling. And after going through the experience a couple different times, or like, you know, book editors are like, oh, this seems really important. I adopted someone from China. And just like experiencing those kinds of comments, I was like, no one should have to experience this again. So I actually started my own publishing company. Like, I figured out how to do it step by step and created it. And then like this became the kind of the test book for it, so that I could help publish other writers, particularly from those underrepresented backgrounds, so that they didn't have to kind of go through this like weird, like pass, like microaggression, like process. And I was just like, for me, like, it's kind of like the nonprofit. I just want to help people with expression and get these stories and experiences out. So whatever I can do to ease the process, I will gladly do. And so this year I'm actually helping publish a book of poetry for an up and coming poet. We've published a couple of books on like traditional folk tales. And so just trying to get these stories out there. And I was like, yeah, like, it's kind of a funny thing. It's kind of like my band. I was like, if the system isn't working for us and it's actually creating harm, then what can we do to like subvert that entirely?
Yeah, I've been told by a pretty famous editor that my name was stupid because I used J.F. Garrard, so Jeannie Von Garrard. So Garrard is actually my husband's last name, but I thought it would be easier because I write a lot of science fiction and fantasy to hide the fact that I'm female and Asian. So that's why I did that. But he was telling me to stop it, but it's, I'm like, well, that's what I've been using. So I don't think, you know, I'm going to stop.
That's your name. I mean, well, J.K. Rowling hid behind initials for the same purpose. And, you know, it's also kind of a pretty common convention for fantasy and sci-fi writers to use initials as well.
Yeah, it's true. So, okay. So this is all the time we have today. So thank you very much for being so generous with us by sharing your story. And I wish you best of luck on all your endeavors.